Hello, welcome to Joe's podcast. Can't remember what number it is, it's five or something. It's been a couple of weeks since I did the last one, I've been away. But I've managed to get a hold of James Ward here. For this week's, James is here. James is nice. It's great to have you here.
Thanks.
Friends! Okay. But yeah, so all jokes aside, James has kindly agreed to come in and do this. It's don't have to sit there, so see, relax, bud. We're just chatting. Just at the rigid scale. Yeah, so we thought we'd talk about training frequency and how it's kind of the way we look at our training. And this isn't not so much in terms of the number of occasions you train in a week, it's the number of times you hit a body part and how that's evolved for both of us over time. And for people that know me, they know I do full body 5 days a week, so I squat pretty much every day. I've got a squat variation. Yourself at the moment, you're doing push pull legs,
transfer into an upper lower.
Yeah, and at the moment you're hitting every body part eight days, twice in 8 days. Which is a bit different from what's become known as the traditional bro split. Legally, everyone in the 90s and before. Mm-hmm. And probably just at the 80s and the 90s, legally, you're only allowed to do chest on a Monday, maybe some triceps. But yeah, that's how I used to train as well. Monday was chest day, Tuesday was legs day, Wednesday was shoulders and arms, Thursday was back, and because I wasn't that bright, Friday would be extra chest. And that's kind of how I trained for years. And that way of me doing it like that Monday to Friday, wasn't great. It wasn't bad. I made a bit of progress, but it wasn't fantastic. But part of the lack of progress would be down to my own lack of knowledge at the time. But I'm always learning at the moment. But I definitely was pretty damn clueless then. Right down to nutrition, good at all, just in things like eating enough and eating enough protein and eating enough carbohydrate just to fuel training and things and my exercise rest, etc. But that aside, now I've finished rambling. I've certainly moved away from that.
I've had a similar start. When I started bodybuilding training, it went straight into the bro split because that was the most common style of training. So whenever you look at anybody in the gym, 90% of people will be doing a chest day on a Monday, shoulders, back, arms, legs, and then maybe another arm day if you're going to. But only after I put in research, like a lot of research, after about a year or two, did I start developing the idea of being able to train more than once. I started doing Ronnie Coleman's style split, which was a big mistake because Ronnie Coleman is obviously one of the greatest bodybuilders of all time, yeah. And I don't have his genetics. But he used to train with a high rolling approach.
The really obvious thing is this Ronnie's really muscly. And he has a slightly darker complexion. And no beard.
And a sense of humour. But he would do a high volume training split of a push-pull legs. But it would be push-pull legs, day off, push-pull legs. So he'd be training 6 days a week, but everything would be, on each day, would be really high volume. Now, over the years, I've got into a lot more research, followed a lot of high-level coaches, and what I've come to understand is that the volume overall, so per week, is what counts. So if you're going to do your chest and you have 20 sets, rather than doing 20 sets in one day, because 3 or 4 days later you're going to be able to do that muscle group again, instead of waiting for a week to do it again, you're wasting 3 days. That's 3 potential days of growth. So you can split your session. If you say to do chest twice in that week, you could do 10 sets on one day, 10 sets on the other day, and you would still get the same benefit. Except on, say, day one, you'd be able to push a lot harder with each set, because you've got less total sets to do, so really you should be able to push to a much heavier weight, or at least to be able to increase the intensity. That coupled over your whole body, would have a more more positive effect on muscle growth. I don't want to go too much into science, but research has proven that untrained people would finish sort of muscle protein synthesis within 72 hours, which is pretty much 3 days. You're going to be able to train that muscle group again. Trained individuals can be 24 to 48 hours, so you can train that muscle group again. Joe being able to train full body every day, he can, because he's a trained individual and his recovery is on point.
I think I'd maybe disagree with you just on the saying that I can because I'm a trained individual. I think I can because of part of the way I train and the way I eat, but just because people can. I don't think it's anything special or certainly nothing special about me or the way I train. Or that, and I get what you're saying about research and things like that. And I've read that, the one about the protein synthesis, everything settles back after 72 hours. But ultimately, a lot of it for me isn't so much about the science paper, it's about common sense. Look at a Draiman, for anyone that doesn't know, these are the guys that deliver the beer barrels to pubs. There's a guy when I used to work in a pub that we just called the Beast. Now this was a guy that could lift a full keg pretty much with one arm and put it over kind of like that. His forearms were like my thighs. These are big guys. Look at people that work on, or maybe less so today, but that's we can come on to that in a bit. But look at people that do a lot of manual tasks. They're strong. To me, if the issue, if you can't train the muscle 2 days in a row, or you shouldn't, these people shouldn't be able to do their job properly. Yes, ultimately they don't have that training intensity that people talk about the gym and bank pre-workout to do their job. But the volume is so much higher. These guys are you're talking 8-10 plus hours a day, doing that on and off throughout the entire day, 5 to 6 days a week. If someone that can do a physical job, demanding job, can do that, and these are heavy weights, they get the same farms, all this sort of stuff, then realistically what we're doing in the gym is a much safer environment, in theory, and much more controlled environment, certainly. And it's not for the same length of time. You don't, ultimately, other than your own time pressures with the rest of your life, you're not under time pressure to just get this thing done. We can take the time to make sure we do it perfectly and action everything correctly and have the safest technique, etc. So if I'm doing training for an hour and a half, 2 hours, I just don't think I'm capable of smashing myself to the point where my body needs, or those muscles in my body, central nervous system is a separate issue, and my muscles need more than those 24 hours for a fairly short amount of time. I tend to take, you know, Saturday and Sunday off, and I'll do exercise with the kids and things. I'll run around and ride bike and things, but I'll not do particularly intensive weight. Yeah, so although I understand what you're saying about research and things and the things you've read, I'd never dispute that and say you're wrong, but mine's come from just common sense and trying it and suddenly finding that actually I made more progress in strength. What really did it for me, I'd moved to an upper-lower split because I liked the idea of a little bit more frequency. Then I did the Wendler program, more squatting. It involved squatting every day, but you also added in chest work and back work every day, is the way the program is built. And I suddenly found out was progressing more, and yeah, that's what did it for me. It was just trying things, not, I hate the phrase thinking outside the box, but yeah, not being blinkered. So
I'll let you speak.
If we're looking at what we're aiming for, so if we're going to be, say, increasing muscle mass, what's been determined as the determining factor of increasing muscle mass is total volume. Now, there's loads of different research on who, you know, what volume's appropriate, what's too much volume, and stuff like that.
I would have thought it'd be actual. Well, it depends what you mean by volume, I suppose. For me, volume can be workload. So you can increase volume threefold.
Yeah.
You can increase, actually, fourfold. Increase volume through more weight, because it's more workload, more sets, more reps, more frequency.
Yeah. Okay. So let's look at volume in terms of sets per week. There's going to have to be a minimum intensity. Intensity has to be at a minimum. From what I can remember, Dr. Mike Israetel, who's done a lot of research with MRV, which is maximum recoverable volume, that's through academic research as well as experience with his own clients. He's found that there is a certain amount of maximum sets, give or take, depending on individuals, per muscle group, providing that the intensity is at a certain level. So I think, if I remember correctly, it was around 80% plus. So if the intensity is the same, but obviously 80% is individual to our own, so we can't all have the same sort of 80%. The maximum recoverable volume, the maximum amount of sets that you can recover from, or the maximum amount of training you can recover from in that week. So if that's, say, like for your back, that could be 25 sets. Now, if you're working 25 sets in the one day, absolutely hammering it, yes, you're going to be bullied, but there's going to be a point in which that after a certain time in that session, that it's going to pretty much pointless.
Your intensity, yeah. In theory, could drop off. I understand that. Another reason, I suppose, for being a fan of high frequency, it's weird. It sounds like you're slagging off the body part split, but I'm going to caveat everything we've been saying in a little bit, because I'm certainly not. This is just something that I've found works well for me, and you've found works well for you. But often, if a bodybuilder's got a lagging body part, the first thing they'll do is train the body part more frequently.
Yeah.
Although ultimately that more frequency isn't just more frequently, they're hitting more volume. So they hit it twice, but it's not that they've split the original volume in two, but they've got a bit more volume. And that got me thinking as well about doing extra. I know you're kind of coming at it from a more scientific angle. For me, it was just common sense. But in terms of intensity, I certainly agree with you. I can be guilty of training for possibly a bit too long, and my intensity later in the session does drop off a bit. That's where I kind of, my arms end up getting neglected a bit, just because I can't be bothered by the time I get to the gym.
That's why I prefer to adopt a very low volume approach. So in my training, most times I will only do two sets per muscle group. Warm-up sets and then maximum intensity sets. Now, the only muscle groups I'll do three sets on would be squats or deadlifts, and that would be it. But that means that if my training session, if I'm doing upper lower, I could be in, if I'm training everything three or four sets, I'll be in there for 3 hours, and that's just far too much. So I try and get my training sessions done between an hour and a half and 2 hours, and that means I'll have to lower the amount of sets I'm doing for that day over, say, my whole upper body. I would prefer to work in two sets of maximum effort, and then that's it, done. Then just continuously hammering the muscle just because I feel that it needs it.
No, that's cool. Whereas mine's different. Yours is all based around
progressive
your training is also very focused on hypertrophy.
Yeah.
Whereas mine is strength. I'm not really focused on getting bigger, nice. Yeah. But I'm trying to get stronger. I'd like to say trying to get stronger. I don't think in the grand scheme of things I'm ever going to be strong. I just want to get stronger than I am now.
Strength is relative to the individual, so whatever you started off with, probably a lot stronger now.
Yes, I started off with espresso, and now I'm just weak. I'm probably, in terms of people in the gym, I'm maybe
the issue is we compare ourselves to other people, and they have nothing to do with us.
That's a whole different point. Let's we're rambling on it. No one gives a crap about what I was. But yeah, so that's the difference as well. You've got two absolute all-out balls-to-the-wall sets, working sets, warm-ups and stuff. Whereas mine, I don't have as many sets like that, or I shouldn't have as many sets like that, because it's my stuff's more based off percentages. Unfortunately, I think that don't always work like that. However, having said all this, we're both fans of higher frequency. Yeah. You, it's a couple of times every 8 day. Me, it's I like squatting every day, and I like hitting every muscle every day. And another reason I'm not a massive fan of getting DOMS, I don't essentially mind it. However, I've kind of just that something John Meadows said to me once that kind of stuck with me is, it's like, you get weaker DOMS, good part of that is actually a lack of recovery. Your body's not recovering well. Now, you can get it from shocking your body, totally different, but it's different if it's basically your body's not, you're stressing it, it's not accustomed to the movement. And if you're regularly getting DOMS from the same movements, maybe you've got something amiss. Maybe it's your rest, your nutrition, or something isn't quite there. Maybe you've been a bit ill. It's every so often you see someone go, I felt rubbish, I had a cold, and I still went and did my session today, and I'm in pieces, I'm in bits. My session was awesome, but no, your recovery was crap. It's not to say your session might have been awesome, but even if it was average, you'd probably still feel rough as hell. But anyway, getting back to the point, I'm not a massive fan of DOMS. I also find that, mainly for strength training, hypertrophy, that DOMS doesn't hit it so much, but I found if my legs are in bits, I can't do like a heavy triple on squats, not effectively. It just doesn't go down well. They'll get done, but they'll be ugly, and it just risks hurt. More frequency, I get less DOMS. I can hit the heavier weights more often, so that's what works for me. However, having said all of that, at the level that most of us are at, and I include myself here, I think I sit somewhere between beginner and intermediate in terms of my training level. I think I'm a bit past it, but I'm not sure I'd even consider myself an intermediate. In terms of my own lifts and things in the gym. It's for me, one of the most important things is your own enjoyment. It's all well and good us sitting here and arguing and saying, you know, you should squat every day, you should do bench every day, the only way to train is full body, 18 days a week sort of thing. Or you going, no, you should do upper lower split 3 times a week, or push full legs, whatever. Well, this is what works for us. The most important thing, I think, and this is my caveat to everything, saying we've both found benefit from higher frequency. Big caveat to that is, actually, as you were saying, it's about intensity. You will find it so much harder to work at the required intensity to make the progress you want, and consistency as well, if you don't enjoy what you're doing. Like, if I went back to a single body part split, there'd be days I'd like, probably. Everyone loves a chesty. But there'd be days I'd dread. I always used to dread leg day because I knew I was going to be crawling out of the gym. Now I don't mind so much. I don't mind doing that to myself. But back then, and there'd be other body parts I'd just loathe doing, thinking about spending half an hour doing arms or something like that. If I'd gone back to that, I wouldn't enjoy it. I probably wouldn't put in the same effort. For me, that's as big a factor is actually if you're enjoying your time in the gym, if you're in that and you can get your head in it and you love it and you're pushing really hard, you'll get more out of it than doing the one that's the supposed optimum way to train. I can sit here and think, personally, I think high frequency is a winner. But if you don't like it, it's not going to work for you. There'll be 20 other people who'd say, you know, completely disagree with me, and who might say they're wrong. because that's what worked for them, because your head, these top 2 inches are so important for your training. If you don't enjoy it, you're not going to progress. So the biggest takeaway from this is find what works for you, that helps you make progress, and try new stuff. You know, don't just believe the method that I followed or the method that he follows for what works for us. I'm not saying, you know, I'd love it if people give it a try, and I'm certainly not slagging off the traditional bro split. I personally don't think it's optimum or that efficient comparatively. However, look at the number of colossal bodybuilders and strongmen and powerlifters that have trained with the muscle groups with a frequency of once a week. So, you know, they all can't be wrong and me right. It is definitely down to the individual, and this is just our personal experience. Okay. So I hope that was kind of useful and worthwhile for some of you. Okay, cheers guys. Bye bye.